Hello and welcome to Tar Heel Teachers at Home. I'm Marlo Artis. I'm the moderator of the program. Tar Heel Teachers at Home is an interview series focused on engaging North Carolinians in conversations around education. Each week, I'm happily joined by a wonderful panel of educators, each one representing a particular subsection of education. We'll start our introductions with our elementary school panelists.
Good afternoon, good evening. My name is Ms. Nikki Brooks. I am the principal at Richmond Elementary School in Shannon, North Carolina. We are approximately 50% Hispanic and 48% Native American, with just a few other multiracial populations there. I have been currently announced as the 2021 Principal of the Year for Public Schools of Robeson County. It comes as a surprise to me. My Twitter handler is at Brooks78. So you can check me out on there.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for joining us and congratulations on that wonderful recognition.
Thank you.
Hey everyone, my name is Amy Tart. I teach in Clay County Schools in Western North Carolina. You can find me on Twitter at Cards for Scholars.
Hello, my name is Micah Tweetmeyer and I teach science at Riverside High School in Durham. And you can follow me on Twitter at Micah J. Hunter.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Arisha Smalls, and I'm the Elementary AIG Program Specialist for Cumberland County Schools, and you can follow me on Twitter at SmallsArisha.
Awesome. October is Countdown to College Month in North Carolina, and for this episode, we are going to discuss two college access programs or development programs at UNC-Pembroke. Dr. Camille Goins is the Project Director for the First Americans Educational Leadership Program, the FAEL program, which works to increase the number of highly effective American Indian administrators. Dr. Leslie Locklear is the project coordinator for the First Americans Teacher Education Program. FATE seeks to increase the number of highly qualified American Indian teachers. Dr. Goins, Dr. Locklear, thank you both so very much for joining us here on Tar Heel Teachers at Home.
Great to be here.
Good to be with you.
We're really excited to talk about the great work that you both are doing. So Dr. Goins, we're going to start with you. Please tell us about the FAEL program. How long has the program been in existence? And tell us about some of the opportunities that are available to your program participants.
Okay. So for starters, UNCP has had a long history with the U.S. Department of Education Office of Indian Education. Dr. Locklear is working with both FATE and the FAEL programs right now as program coordinator. So she's duly enrolled in working with that. So those programs began in 2000. And in 2018, we were given the opportunity to apply for an additional grant that focused on preparing administrators, school administrators in the Masters of School Administration program. And although we had a teacher education program for the last 18 years, we pursued this grant and were successful and was awarded a $1.1 million grant to bring on about 20 aspiring administrators. And I'm proud to say that we have exactly 23 at the moment enrolled in our program. So we have exceeded our goal. Our goal, while we do pay full tuition and fees, the primary goal of our program is a training program. So it's professional development and training focused on preparing these individuals to work in highly populated American Indian schools and communities. In North Carolina, and of course, we partnered with three counties, and we have recently brought on Cumberland County as one of our counties as well. But we partnered with Scotland, Robeson, and Hope County because those three counties represented the most population of Native Americans in those districts. So we were preparing school administrators for those particular districts. So while we do pay for tuition and fees, our primary goal is for training and professional development. So we spend a lot of time in offering opportunities for our participants to go to national and state conferences, although this year it has been a little bit different, but they've still been able to do that. And we provide professional development on a monthly basis. The one plus to our program is that we're able to provide a pre-service mentor. So they are given a mentor throughout the entire program while they're in college taking their classes. And then once they are placed, which we are not at that phase just yet, but once they are placed in administrative role, they're given an induction mentor, which does not typically come with a principal program. So that's one of the advantages. In addition to that, one of our goals is to reduce the barriers that many minority students face in pursuing higher education, especially graduate degrees. So for our students who have children under the age of 18, we provide a monthly stipend or dependent care stipend for each of those children under that age. And then if they choose to work part-time, we also can provide them with an employment stipend or training stipends, so they actually can go to school full time and focus solely on their schoolwork, even in graduate school. And we have had several students to take advantage of that. So by reducing those barriers, they have a greater chance of being successful in graduate school and really getting the training that they need to be successful once they enter into the field.
That is wonderful. Very comprehensive. So many different components to make sure that the students, the participants are successful. Dr. Locklear, tell us about the FAEL program and the work that you all do.
Sure. So Dr. Goins and I actually came on at UNCP at the same time working with the FAEL program. And through the FAEL program, like we said, I think the short and simple version that I always tell people is that we train American Indian teachers to go back and teach and serve in American Indian classrooms. We really value that culture responsive education and that representation when it comes to education. Like the fall program, we also provide a stipend and we also provided a dependent care stipend. And we were heavily invested in professional development opportunities for our students as it related to anything in the world of education. And another aspect that both of our grants have in common is that we also provide school supplies. So when our teachers go into the classroom, we provide a certain amount of money, different ones for our different grants, and that we purchase school supplies that they can utilize in their classroom. So we are based kind of in the same idea with the same framework. We also have a mentor that serves our educational teachers as well. But I think the number one goal is that we're seeking to develop administrators and also educators in terms of that representation in our local community.
Awesome. And we know that representation matters, and it's really beneficial for the students in those highly populated areas to see someone that looks like them in their school leadership role and also as the teacher in the classroom. What questions do we have for Dr. Locklear and Dr. Goins?
I'll start. Well, first I want to say that I have myself two master's degrees that I earned from UNCP. I have a master's in reading, K-12, and I also have a master's in school administration. And I just finished that program about 2 years ago. And I was the recipient of, or the member of the Sandhills Regional Education Consortium. Mm-hmm. And your program sounds a little bit similar to that, where you have a pre-service mentor and then you have a mentor once you finish. That has been something that was really beneficial to me, someone that you could call on, and they're always there for you. And so I do like that that is a part of your program. I do have a question about the stipend that you offer through your programs. Is that, do the students receive that as a grant? Or is there a promise to work in the area for a certain amount of years? How does that work?
So the training program is a payback. It's either service or cash payback. So for the amount of time that they are within the program, that's the amount of time that they are committed to pay back in service to a community that is highly populated Native American. And since we have a partnership primarily with those three districts, that's where we are training our participants to go and work in those three districts. So if they do not, or if they are not able to fulfill their service payback, then they go into a cash payback process.
Yes, and it's the same for the FAEL program. We are a service payback opportunity with the option, the very last option, to be cash payback.
Right. It's very rare that they have to go into a cash payback due to the partnerships that you have, the training that they received, and the time that they... the options that they have in getting placed into an employment agency.
I was just curious about that part. Because of the program that I was a part of, we did have the service payback. So mm-hmm. that's what I did too. Right. What does support look like in that year when they, I know you said you haven't placed any people just yet. They're still in the program. They haven't completed that yet. But what does support, what will support look like that first year?
Oh, you can go ahead, Dr. Goins.
Do you want to know for admin? It will be the same. So I'll let Leslie talk about it. But for both programs, the induction part will be the same type of support, except one will be for aspiring administrators and or administrators, and one will be for teachers. So you can go ahead.
And so our grant actually came to an end and the end of September 30th, the FAEL did, and we have a no-cost extension for a year. So we have had people roll into the induction portion where they were employed as educators. And we have a retired educator from the American Indian community who served as that mentor with them throughout their first year of teaching. And that is the same that we envision for our school administrators who are fresh into their new position, is that they will have that one-on-one support. So depending on how many students I had rolling into induction at a time, at some points in time, she was meeting weekly and visiting every single student in their classroom and having that one-on-one emotional and social support, and also providing that feedback as we continued to increase people. At least she still saw them twice a month. So we really valued that one-on-one mentoring that we were able to provide. And I know for Dr. Goins and the fall program that that is a number one goal as we roll students into induction, is that they have that focused mentoring, because that's a critical part of both programs.
And I have one more piggyback, y'all, and then I'm going to stop. So this question is, are you planning for the program to continue professional development into that first year as well? Or will it just be mentorship?
It's both. They continue to get professional development throughout the process, the whole long term of the grant. So even if after they have graduated and they've completed their pre-service training, they continue to receive professional development.
And I think that that's one thing when Dr. Goins rewrote the fall grant, we noticed that that was something in FAEL that we wish was built in. So it almost was like our undergraduate students, when you graduated, you got our mentor, but we didn't continue to build that PD portion of it. So I really appreciate that the administrator's grant continues to build in that, so they stay with our cohort a little bit longer.
Right. And one additional thing that we added into that is that we pay for them to be a part of a professional organization. And so with that also comes professional development if they choose to go to those conferences. So that's a part of it as well.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, I have a question. Being an administrator in Robeson County, Ms. Dr. Leslie, how many people do you have involved? How many students do you have enrolled currently in the education department?
So in my program or just?
Yes, ma'am. Your program.
The four-year grant for FAEL had 33 participants that enrolled throughout the 2016 through 2020 term of that grant. This is a grant that we've had quite a while, and it was something that personally I didn't know much about. And I know when Dr. Goins and I came in that, of course, with grants, one thing we found is that there's a lot of turnover. So people have left and people have come back. So we've heard of a lot of people that have come through this program that are alumni of the FAEL program. So it's definitely inspiring to hear. But we did have 33, and we exceeded our goal as well of having 30. So we did have a total of 33 come through the program. Not all, unfortunately, completed, but we were happy to have at least 33.
Now, are they lateral entry, or are they already working as teachers, or are they trying
we
to complete
run
the program?
We run the entire gamut. So we have elementary, middle, high school, lateral entry, master's, arts, English, math. So we had quite a bit, which I think Dr. Goins and I realized also provided some difficulty when it came to providing monthly professional development, because we were trying to cover a lot with a lot of different people. So it was definitely a learning experience, particularly for me with the elementary ed background. But we do run the gamut. We had lateral entry. We had some that had been teaching 2 to 3 years. We had some that just fresh in the game. So we were all over the map when it came to education.
And we've actually had a few that were FAEL participants that are now in our fall program. Mm-hmm. So they've taken advantage of both of these grant opportunities.
That's great.
Dr. Locklear, you spoke about kind of one challenge you've had with like the PD development, but what have been some other roadblocks to both of these programs?
I think for FAEL, I think the number one roadblock was the continual change of laws when it came to lateral entry and the licensure testing. The licensure testing still to this day is one of the biggest barriers that we face in our lateral entry teachers will complete the programming portion, but then struggle with that licensure portion. So that is something that we've continued to struggle with. And it almost becomes that battle of an educator where I don't want to teach to a test, but at this point, the test is my barrier that I need to address. And so right now, a lot of our PD and what we provide is solely around that licensure exam because we're at the end of our grant. So we have a lot of program completion, but not licensure completion.
In which areas are they having the hardest time passing them tests? Is it elementary reading or is it middle school? I know social studies is one of the hardest ones to pass in middle school. What areas are they having difficulty passing the test in?
So I will say that our math educators, both middle and high, have overwhelmingly done well. So math for middle and high have done well. We have some struggles when it comes to art. So the K-12 arts integration, and when it comes to elementary education, both the reading and the math.
Mm-hmm. In Cumberland County, we have what's called a local requirement for all of our AIG teachers who have put AIG identify kids in their classes or potentially gifted kids in their class. It's an online professional development that we offer here in our district. But that doesn't qualify a teacher to be an AIG teacher within our program. We do normally encourage them to seek out a licensure add-on program. And I know that UNCP has a licensure add-on program. Do you encourage your undergrads to take advantage of those courses that are offered to get that additional licensure before graduating?
And actually, that's a great question. That's not something that we were as familiar with when we came into the grant. And I know particularly, and I keep going back to me and Dr. Goins coming in together, we came in on the tail end of the FAEL grant. And my goal is to rewrite next year. And that is something that I want to encourage. And we also were able to encourage some of our students to even take some of the required graduate classes to move on to a master's degree in their field. But that add-on licensure is definitely something that I wish we could have hopped on the train a little earlier when it came to that grant completion. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Because that would having that additional license will make them more marketable. Yes, North Carolina needs teachers. There's vacancies everywhere, but every school needs something different. And I think having a specialized license like that will open up more doors. Mm-hmm.
You guys both mentioned that your program was able to recruit more than you were hoping for. So how are you guys going and attaining these teachers and enticing them into the program?
Multiple ways. most want to go back and pursue, in my program, of course, it's a master's degree. So they're already working full time and have been working for quite some time. And they want to go back to school, but many of the barriers that they were facing, both financially, having that extra incentive in just the resources that we provide that they're not able to afford, and try to work and go to school at the same time. So those were some of the incentives in doing that. Offering the professional development, the support. As we mentioned, they get a pre-service mentor, but they also have a network of support. If you were in the Sand Hills program, you're familiar with that as well, but there's a wide, you know, variety of individuals that are working with them, and they have this whole network of support because, and Nikki, I'm sure you're familiar with this, when you go into an administrative role, you're the only one there. So having that network of support is there, and that was very helpful to them, knowing that they would have that moving forward in this and that they wouldn't be alone. And also we've made it a way for them to move through the program at a very rapid pace. They could move as quickly as they wanted to, or slow down if they needed to. So laying out a detailed program of study for them based on their individual needs was helpful. And doing just lots of presentations and talking about that. But I think Leslie and I both have really emphasized the needs of being culturally responsive and working with diverse communities and schools in which we saw, and when we did our research and as we wrote this grant, how diverse our schools were, but yet we weren't really being responsive to the needs of our students. And in some cases, for example, with Hope County and Scotland County, they have a large Native American population, yet there were no Native American administrators. And so that was enticing for many of those to come into the program because they want to be there and work in those schools and serve in that capacity. So just a variety of different ways, but I think really helping them, even though they're Native American educators, helping them to understand more about their own culture and how they can bring that into the classroom and then extend that to a larger scale from the school level. And then many of our participants have gone on and presented at larger conferences, not just locally, but moving on to the state and even looking at the national level. So really getting out there, getting them the opportunity to be more innovative, more creative, and stepping out of just that singular classroom atmosphere has been helpful.
So when you all look at the partnering districts, how committed are they, are those systems to placing these administrators? So if you say that Scotland County, Hope County do not, they have the percentage of students, but they don't have the administrators. How committed are they going to be to hiring these individuals once they graduate and complete the fall program?
Well, let me start by saying when we write a grant, we write it with the current administrative team. And in some cases, there is some turnover even in that capacity. So just continuing to develop relationships with those on that senior level administrative team. And now even our program has a new dean. So we're trying to start a new partnership and start new advisory committees so that they understand what the purpose is of our program and what we're trying to do and the benefits of what we want to bring and offer to their school systems. So of course we do have two school systems within our partnership that of course have had a change in administration at the senior level. So again, we're working with our new dean to develop those partnerships to help place our participants. Unfortunately, we do have some time in between their graduation and actually getting them placed. So we work with them on job preparation, portfolio development, and getting them to start the application process and interview process so they could start going through that. So whereas some programs you may immediately need to be placed in employment, we do get a window of time from the time they graduate to the time to actually get placed in employment. So that gives us some time to continue to build those relationships with those districts.
That is wonderful. And one thing I think that would help is DPI with their school personnel demographics. If we could actually parse out how many American Indian teachers and administrators that we have, because when I look at that website, I know how many female teachers we have, how many male, I know how many Black, how many white, and then we move to other. And so I don't know how many American Indian administrators and teachers we have, how many Latinx. So that's a problem when we're calling people other and we're not really sparsing out, because then we don't know what that number really is. So we need to know what progress we need to make.
Exactly. And that's something that we had, of course, when writing the grant, that's data sets that we need when we're writing the grant. So you have to seek out other individuals at DPI to get that information that you need. And that's how we really narrowed down what was needed. That's my dog barking. That's how we narrowed down what was needed.
Your dog agrees with us that we need that data.
He's saying, yes, I agree with what you're saying. So that's how we narrowed down the percentage of administrators that were in those other counties, Hope and Scotland. And Scotland has a very large Native American student population. It's about 15%. Mm-hmm. And so that was really, of interest, that we really wanted to help train administrators to go into that field in Scotland County as well.
That's great. And Dr. Locklear, you are also on the DRIVE task force, the governor's task force. What kind of conversations are you all having at the state level as it relates to increasing the number of American Indian teachers and administrators in our state?
So our conversations have quite honestly centered around this same conversation, is what is the problem that we're experiencing? What are the barriers when it comes to recruitment of educators of color, of administrators of color? How are we going to rectify this issue? Where do the issues exist? Is it recruitment? Is it retention? So we have broken our committee into so many smaller subcommittees because we're focusing on that pipeline all the way from K through 12 through graduation to figure out where the holes are. I will say that the number one conversation that we've been having lately in terms of educator prep and where are our educators of color is salary. I know that comes as no surprise to anybody on this call, is that it's hard to recruit people and tell them you're going to make this much, but you're going to change the world. So take this much and change the world. So we actually had some of our local educators on a call, and one of our FAPE participants on a call, on a panel, and by far and large, when it comes to that task force, I think it's going to rise to the top that one of our, while we all have a lot of recommendations we want to make, that salary is one of those recommendations, especially in a rural, poor community, that it's hard for me to justify recruiting people to a profession that I know changes the world, but may cause hardships in their personal life.
Mm-hmm. Especially when poverty is a cycle they're trying to break.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to ask if there's any other states or university systems that have programs like this, or programs that you admire, and what type of collaboration you guys do with other states.
Well, we're one of very few on the East Coast. Most are out West. I think there's one in, actually there was an administrative program at Penn State years ago. And I think maybe up in Connecticut, there may be a grant program similar to the FAPE program, which trains teachers. Most are out West, in New Mexico and Arizona. So we've been fortunate to continue to receive this grant because we do have a large Native American population on the East Coast that we serve. And just in our particular area, out of all the Native American students in North Carolina, the three counties that I mentioned that we're partnering with, we serve about 62% of Native American students. So that is a great need, and why we've been successful in continuing getting these grants, because we are trying to help train students to go and work in these Native American communities. And of course, we have one of the largest districts that has a Native American population. That does, as Nikki said, it's difficult to recruit individuals to this area, to stay in this area. There's a lot of turnover in this area. So the ultimate goal is that we are training them to stay here and want to progress even after they've done their service, but that they want to continue to stay here and help others to continue to this work.
Yeah, I think the beauty of what we're trying to develop is a grow your own, in that you know the community, you know the people, and you're very familiar, but yet we can bring in these outside resources and this outside knowledge to internally transform the world of education that a lot of our participants have gone K through 12 in the schools that they are going to go back and work in. And so how can we transform your experience so that generations later, thinking traditionally as a Native, seven generations down the line, that this is going to be different? And I think Dr. Goins definitely doesn't give herself enough credit. We also have a person who moved all the way here from another state, all the way out West, who wanted to be a part of this program. And I thought that was so amazing that he had heard about the program, but the relationship that Dr. Goins built with him and letting him know that we're here to support you, we're here to provide that support as you move so far across state lines, because he was willing to serve and work in our community, I think is really valuable and says a lot about the program itself.
It does. Well, we want to thank you both so very much for coming on Tar Heel Teachers at Home and talking about this great work. And we would love for you all to come back and give us some updates on your progress, because we certainly think that this is really valuable work and we'll do anything that we can to support it.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah,
thank you both so much. Absolutely. We'd also like to thank our wonderful audience so very much for watching this episode. Please follow us on our social media platforms. Please like our Facebook page. Follow us on Twitter. Our handle is @TarHeelTeachers. Follow us on Instagram. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Visit our website, tarheelteachers.com. And on all of our social media platforms, please use our #TarHeelTeachers so we can find all of your great comments. We'd like to thank our wonderful group of panelists for joining us for this conversation. Nikki Brooks, Amy Tart, Micah Tweetmeyer, and Arisha Smalls. And we'd like to thank our special guests for joining us, Dr. Camille Goins and Dr. Leslie Locklear. We look forward to seeing you next time on Tar Heel Teachers at Home.